When I say the word algae, the first thing that may come to mind for you is something like the swamp monster. I mean, algae is just plain old pond scum, right? Well, recently, Lawrence Livermore National Lab was given a $3.5 million grant to keep working on scientific projects about algae. But why? What about algae is so important? Today, we're going to talk to three scientists and learn what algae is, why it's important, hint, it can be used as a biofuel and to capture carbon, and how we're collaborating with other labs to bring algae technology to reality. Now, let's go learn about some green squishy stuff.
Rhona, what is this lovely flask of greenness?
So these are called microalgae.
Okay.
So microalgae are single-celled organisms. Mm-hmm. They're aquatic usually, they grow in water. Algae is a big group.
There's
a bunch of different organisms that are included in it, but mm-hmm. they're all sort of single-celled organisms, and the thing they all have in common is that they photosynthesize. Actually, these green algae here, these are green algae, this is Anemophoropsis, mm-hmm. and this is a direct sort of plants, all land plants came from green algae.
Oh my gosh, wow, so we're talking to someone very important here.
Yes.
Okay, so why do we care about algae? What's important about them?
So first of all, we care about them because they're very important to our planet, right?
Right.
They're a base of the food chain and a lot of ecosystems in the world, and the oceans sort of everywhere, they're the base of the food chain. But we can also use them for cool things. So for example, we can use them to make fuel. They naturally make lipids, which we can make into biodiesel and just put directly in our cars.
Whoa, like my car that I have outside that's just like
car?
Normal?
Uh-huh.
So in theory, you could have this wonderful sort of cyclical loop of feeding algae CO2 and then having the algae be a fuel.
Yes.
And you could even use recycled water.
Right.
So this would be part of like a very sustainable cycle.
Yes, that's the whole idea, is that they can be sort of a sustainable biofuel product.
Sure.
That they're not bringing more CO2 into the atmosphere. They're taking it out, then you burn it and put the same back in.
Okay.
But unlike fossil fuels that have been buried for millions of years, this isn't extra CO2. So it's the carbon neutral.
It's all being sort of encapsulated in this one loop.
Yes.
Okay.
Exactly. So you take out the biofuel, but you can also take the rest of that biomass that isn't the lipids and the diesel that
sure.
we want, and you can use that for animal feed, let's say.
Okay.
So you can use it as fertilizer. So people are experimenting with that. It can also be used for human consumption. So that's already some spirulina, which people may have heard
that's
of.
That's algae?
That's algae.
I had no idea.
Yeah. And the other thing is you could, because algae are these tractable organisms that we can genetically engineer, you can also have them make really whatever you want, any bioproducts. They can make insulin or something like that that's a, a compound that we usually have E. coli.
Right.
But here you could have an algae make it so that
algae
you get
might be a little more manageable.
Okay, Rhona explained what algae is and gave us some examples of how it can be used, like breeding genetically modified algae to produce compounds we can use in medicine, like insulin. She also mentioned that her team is working with another group at the lab to use algae for carbon capture. But how does that work?
So Jenny, tell us a little bit about what you do here in this lab.
Today we're working with some microcapsules. They're actually a polymer or a type of plastic that encapsulates a liquid solvent. And the solvent's purpose is to absorb carbon dioxide. And for these particular capsules, the solvent that they contain is sodium carbonate. So it's a really pretty benign substance that you might find around your household, especially after it absorbs CO2.
Okay.
It converts into the bicarbonate form, which you would know as baking soda.
I was just talking to Rhona about her work with the algae. How is this related to the algae?
So we've been working for several years on designing these microcapsules with different solvents to absorb CO2.
Mm-hmm.
And the idea is that they'll be used in a coal-fired power plant to absorb the CO2 from the emissions from the plant.
Okay.
But then we started wondering, so we're getting really good at capturing the CO2. What do we do with it once we have it? And one idea that we had is maybe we can take the CO2 and we can feed it to algae, because algae needs CO2 to grow.
Okay, that's amazing. Yeah, because Rhona was just telling me that when they're growing the algae, one of the limiting factors is the amount of CO2, because the algae always need more because it's what they eat, and sometimes you don't have enough of it. So if you can give them a material that's producing this CO2, then that's a perfect solution. So where does the collaboration with Sandia come into this?
We're going to be testing our materials in some of their pilot scale tanks. So this is rather than a bench scale here, we're going to be moving it to something that's like the size of a bathtub.
And full of green goop.
Yes.
Tell me a little bit about the different kinds that you have here. So I see you have capsules. What else are you guys playing with?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, we're looking at a few different geometries. So one other thing that we have the technology to do here is to 3D print the same kind of material. So this is also polymer with carbonate.
Okay.
And then we can put these little meshes into the tanks to release the CO2.
I really like what you said about the transport problem, because of course if you have this coal-fired power plant, you don't want to have an algae pond right next to it.
Yeah.
And so in this form, whether it's a mesh or some capsules, they're really easy to transport to wherever you want them to go feed the algae.
Yeah, we'll have it probably in a somewhat dry form,
sure,
absorbing the CO2. It could be that the gases bubbled through a bunch of the capsules, so they might look something like this.
Gotcha.
And then once it's filled with CO2, then it will be transported to the pond. Mm. And then when we put it in the pond, it will probably swell a little bit. It'll absorb some water as the CO2 is being released.
Man, Jenny's work is so cool. I mean, 3D printable, portable carbon capture technology? That really makes me geek out. But she does all of her work on a small scale right now. How are we gonna bring that to a larger scale? Like it would need to be in real life when used at a real power plant. Lawrence Livermore is working on algae projects in collaboration with the California site of Sandia National Labs, where they have something called an algae raceway. What the heck is that? And how are they using it?
These are our open algae raceway ponds.
Okay.
So we're growing a bunch of algae to try to understand how we could translate this to outdoor culture.
Okay, so this is the scaling up of like the little flasks that
I saw
in Rhona's lab.
Okay,
and so why do we need to do it on a bigger scale here?
It's a great question. I think it's the $1 million question for algae cultivation.
Sure.
Is how do we take those really exciting results that we see in the lab and translate them to a large scale cultivation facility?
Okay, and so there are all kinds of problems that arise when you're trying to scale up, as we say.
Exactly, yeah, so changes in the conditions, so the growth conditions, extreme weather events, predators, pathogens, things that can be unintentionally introduced to the pond. So those are all things we're looking at.
So I want to take a closer look at these because these are really cool.
Yeah, come on.
What's the big wheel doing? Why is it moving this way?
Well, we call this a raceway because the algae are essentially racing away around in one direction, kind of like race cars, so to speak, in water. We do this to mix the algae so they get all the nutrients they need. And the light is distributed in a way that helps them grow as fast as possible and as dense as they possibly can.
Okay, that makes sense. And so is this one using any of like the microcapsules that we saw in Jenny's lab?
No, this is a control
where
we're just using air, so it's carbon dioxide from the air to provide to the algae. And so we expect that when the CO2 capsules are provided, we'll actually see an additional boost to the productivity and density that we see here.
And so what's the next step in this project? Where are you guys gonna go from here?
Well, so the next step would be to introduce the capsules and see how they perform. It seems that the technology you guys deliver is very well suited because the carbon dioxide is released from the capsules at exactly the pH that these are at.
Nice.
And so it's a really nice synergy between our two technologies.
Well, it's been really fun to see them. They're quite glorious in their emerald beauty. So thank you for showing me.
Thank you.
Today, we talked to three really cool scientists who are committed to using one of the most ancient organisms on Earth to solve some of our modern world's most pressing problems, like providing sustainable fuel for transport, producing important biomolecules, capturing carbon emissions from power plants, and lots more applications that are related to our everyday well-being and to our nation's safety and security. I'm really excited to see where this technology goes, and we'll keep you updated on any exciting developments, so subscribe to this channel to stay up to date with the science coming out of the lab. Let us know if you have any questions about algae in the comments below. Thanks for watching, and we'll catch you next time. Stay cool, and green, and slimy. Oh wait, that's just algae.